Good morning and a very warm welcome from All Saints Church, Ecclesall. My name is Beth Keith and I'm one of the associate vicars here. Today is the last week before Advent and I hope you've seen on our website and in our notices all the plans that we've got in place for Advent and the Christmas season. Next Sunday evening, we'll be having a joint Advent service together with St Gabriel's. And we're putting together a special service of readings, music that's been specially prepared by the worship teams and the choir. And also Alistair from St Gabriel's will be preaching at that service. So do join us online next Sunday evening. Today in the church calendar, we celebrate Christ the King. So let's begin our service by lifting our voices to sing together, In Christ Alone, My Hope Is Found. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. And may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's sing together the Gloria.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory.
Speak, O Lord, and fulfill Reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 to 14. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The second reading is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. Salt and light. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, my name is Hannah Chester. I'm on the ministry team here at All Saints. I'm going to be speaking to you this morning, but before we do that, let us begin by praying. Lord God, I pray that we can interpret your word, that you may speak to us, and we may hear your message. Amen. So, I have seen a lot of Christmassy things go up around Sheffield recently. If you have been to the city centre, you will have seen that they have put all the really exciting Christmas lights up. And I've seen that people have started to put up their Christmas trees, and there's lots of present buying. Everything's gone very Christmassy. And I hate to say it, but I'm a Christmas starts in December gal. I don't know, I'm just always a bit reluctant to go any further than November 31st. But the thing that got me recently is that I saw a Facebook post of someone talking about their New Year's resolution plans. Now, to me, this seems a bit far, but I do understand that the more prepped that you get, the more it probably pays off. However, I feel like this is a bit too forward thinking. Maybe the issue isn't that it's too early, maybe it's that it makes me think of my own resolutions that I made earlier this year. The goals that I set myself at the beginning of the year, or at the beginning of the summer, or even at the start of the term, or at the start of this lockdown, or at the start of the last lockdown, feel like a long gone thing. And I've lost motivation at various times. Especially now it's colder and darker. For me, it's not the time to start thinking about these. One of my resolutions was that I was going to run every day at one point in the summer. Every day I was going to go and run. So I went on my first run. I'd not run in about a year previous. So I got my trainers out, got some sort of gym clothing on, and off I went. But my trainers weren't right, the clothes were too baggy, it didn't fit right, my calves were aching, and so I figured that I'd got the technique wrong. And I've not got the right music playlist, and I'd just not picked a good route. Everything had gone wrong on this first run. So that week I decided that before I went on my next run, I would, research a little bit about my technique so that my running theory was down to a T. Spent hours looking for the best motivating songs and creating a playlist. I even downloaded this app called Strava. Some of you fitness people might already have it, that tracks your route and you can plan one on it too. Downloaded that. Spent hours preparing to start running, but then I lost interest. I spent too long and there was always something more that I wanted to do to prepare myself. So I could basically be the most incredible runner by the time that I started. I've done the same before with trying to switch up my diet a bit, another one of my resolutions this year. So I've read all the books. I've researched all the things that I could. There's fat-free, carb-free, sugar-free. There's even some that are very specific to just eating one type of food. I've talked to everyone that I can think of that has tried these different things to feel healthier, feel brighter, get a bit leaner and fitter. But then, after I talk about one, I see a different way that someone has done, and I research that instead. And it's not often that I've then started any of them after all of the hours of research I've done about it. And if I do, I spend so long procrastinating, creating meal plans, shopping lists, and basically preparing in every way that I possibly can. And I mask it by calling it well prepared. But I never actually get around to starting it. So I can tell you that this year I've been on very little runs. And I have done very little healthy eating. But I know everything I would ever need to know and more about either of these things. Yet, I still feel like I should keep prepping, just in case. Maybe you can relate to this with something you've tried this year. Here's another example I hear a lot. I can't talk about faith because I've not got the expertise. Or I can't possibly have that conversation with that person yet because they might ask me about a book of the Bible I don't. Not only do I hear it, I've said those things. In the past, I've even decided that I need to read a commentary, two articles, and have a conversation with a faith mentor before I can talk to people about Jesus. Just in case I get asked something really existential. Just in case I get asked about a quote in the Bible that I haven't really read in context. Just in case, and just in case again. Maybe it was because I really wanted to be informed. And of course it's good to be informed and clued in on God's word. But if I'm honest, it's the just-in-case excuse I use when I don't feel motivated. Or it seems like it could be difficult. Or when I'm a bit scared. Or if I actually need to change something about what I'm doing. Some of it is me wanting to be the best at something before I've started. If I'm the best at something before I've started something, when I attempt it, people are like, whoa, that's amazing. was doing all of these things, I was missing the point. And actually missing it meant that I wasn't light. I wasn't salt. I wasn't really doing anything except being nearly light, or nearly salt. But the thing is, Jesus doesn't say, you are the salt of the earth, if you read all the commentaries. He doesn't say, you are the light of the world, if you prepped all the possible conversations you could ever have before you have them. The thing is, it's not about the knowledge, it's actually about the heart behind it. It says in our Ephesians passage, it's goodness, righteousness, and truth. And actually, if you've encountered Jesus, it's just following his example. In fact, if you want to read a handbook, we've got the Bible. But even then, we can narrow it down to just one verse. Love the Lord your God with all your soul, all your heart, and all your mind. Love your neighbour as you would yourself. And if we do this, we are salt and light. And if salt loses its saltiness, if we lose that purpose, it is no longer good for anything. The light under the bowl is good for nothing. In verse 13 in our Ephesians passage, it says that everything exposed to the light becomes visible. And everything that is then visible, that illumination, becomes a light. So if we take that equation, let's put us into it. So let's say that Jesus is the light. Jesus shines on us, we encounter him, we see him, and we then become visible because of it. We become illuminated. But here's the thing I've missed time and time again. There is a next step. We're visible, we're illuminated, but we're not light yet. We only become the light when we choose to act like the light, the Jesus light. We encounter, we are illuminated, but then because of that, because of that encounter, we choose to change and we choose to become light. And I mean, I've often thought, well, knowing Jesus is enough. Encountering the light is enough. And sometimes it is. Jesus can and has worked in that. But it's also the bare minimum. There's a call to action here to change, to imitate the true light and become lights ourselves. It says, wake up, sleeper. Wake up, sleeper. Wake up and act. Wake up, you're losing your saltiness. You're losing your light. Rise from the dead, rise from the unmotivation, rise from the just in case, because Christ will shine on you. Believing isn't enough. We as disciples have a distinct call to be different, to be light, and to bring his kingdom in this process. Wake up, sleeper. Christ will shine on you. He is going to help you because he is the light source. He's the candle we get our flame from. And without him, we can't be light. He will guide us in how we live. And as it says in verse 8, we can live as children of light. Today is Christ the King Sunday, and it is all about acknowledging that Jesus is the King who brings kingdom. And ultimately, we are called to action to be part of this kingdom. And he has the authority over darkness. When I read the verses I would be preaching on today, I needed them. I needed that wake-up call. I needed that push to get up. And I needed that reminder that actually, I have a purpose. It's the time of year, it's the weather changing, it's the lockdown, it's the tragedies of COVID, the loneliness of COVID. It's all sorts of things, but I needed this wake-up call. Because there's lots of darkness out there, and people do need this light. But within this wake-up call, there is the promise that Christ is shining on you too. too. That's the promise that we can trust, and you don't have to have it all sorted, and you don't have to pretend to be light. Jesus is going to help you. Christ will shine on you. He wants to take that and shine on others. Just by purely loving others and showing the hope of God to them. So I'd like you to call to mind something that you may have been putting off. Maybe it's the person you're avoiding conversation with. Maybe it's the Bible study that you've been meaning to do, the invitation that you've been wanting to give. And just as we finish, open your hands in front of you and lay that before God. Ask Him to shine upon you and give that up to Him. And as we do this, I'm just going to pray. Lord God, we give ourselves up to You. Show us how we can be the light of the world. Amen. So as we commit ourselves to God, let's affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We turn now to our time of intercession, which is led by Fenella Noble.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for His goodness. Lord our God, as we find ourselves outside what we think of as normal, experiencing anxiety and lack of control, may we remember the Israelites in the desert, having left behind all they were familiar with and having to find a way across hostile territory. May we learn to worship You in temporary shelters, to trust in You for provision, and to create new ways to express our love for each other. May we allow the letting go of some of the old ways and be ready to embrace new opportunities. May we be salt and light in our neighbourhood communities. Thank You that we are no longer people who go to church, but people who are church. We pray for Your kingdom to come in our hearts and for it to shine out through what we say, what we do, and what we make and how we work. We pray Your blessing and peace on us all, knowing that we are Your people and You are our God, that we belong to You and to each other. We praise You for the beauty of this autumn, for conversations with friends and family, for our breath and our life, for music and dance, for photography and painting. Praise to you, God, for the sacrifices of our key workers, for our carers, our leaders, our researchers, our government, and for the peace of our country. May we always be conscious of your presence within us, in our pain, in our grief, in our loving, and in our praise. May we have the strength to acknowledge you and to give you the glory. May we pray at all times, using words if necessary. May we forgive rather than blame. May we let go of our rights and take up our responsibilities. May we follow the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
To crown all things, there must be love, to bind all together and complete the whole. Let the love of Christ rule in our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for you. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink, in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Wondrous story. I
Thank you for joining with us this morning. And as we close, hear these words of blessing. Christ, our King, make you faithful and strong to do his will, that you may reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.